أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله ثم الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. Dear viewers, Assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is with great pleasure that we accept this invitation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be His guest in this most holiest of months. The Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, just before the advent of the month of Ramadan, mentions in a famous sermon that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has invited you to His banquet. It is of great importance to understand that Allah has found you and I worthy of inviting us to His banquet. There are people who were with us last year who have passed away by this advent of Ramadan. And there are people who may not be able to accept this month of Ramadan. Maybe they are traveling. Maybe circumstances are such that they won't be able to fast in the month of the holy month of Ramadan. So we should be extremely grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has given us this life, He has given us health, and most importantly, He has given us this understanding of this most beautiful religion that He has given to the majority of us on a plate. Many of us have not had to strive hard and exert great effort in arriving on the path of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, on this path of Tawheed, on this path of God. Many of us were born into this religion. Others have had to struggle, strive hard in order to arrive at it. We must thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this most beautiful gift that He has given us. And when it comes to the holy month of Ramadan, we should know that He has selected it above all other months. All the months obviously have their benefits, but the holy month of Ramadan stands out from the rest of the months. It's the month that Allah has chosen for Himself. It is the greatest of months, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen the greatest of actions to be performed in it. After the salah, which is there as obligatory, He makes it obligatory upon you and I to fast. Fasting, as you know, is one of those actions where it's not possible to have pride in. Many actions when you and I perform them, for example, when we pray, it's possible that we pray slowly when people are around us. It's possible that we pray in a beautiful tune, we recite in a beautiful tune so people can hear us. It's possible that we wake up in the middle of the night so that other people are aware of our actions. This obviously brings down the value of that action. However, when it comes to fasting, it's not possible for you to know that I'm fasting or for me to know that you're fasting. It's an act that is done in absolute secrecy between a servant and his most beloved Lord. It's an act that you will only find out about if somebody actually says something about it. It's only if I come out and tell you that I'm fasting will you know. For that reason, it's an act of secrecy. And between two lovers, the most intimate actions are those actions which are secret and nobody else is aware of them. Hence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about fasting, that fasting is for me and I am its reward. There are some actions where Allah says that the reward of this action will be, for example, to increase your lifespan. If you do this action, your sins will be forgiven. Another action, it's equivalent to Hajj and Umrah. But when it comes to fasting, Allah says, I am its reward. It's as if the reward cannot be mentioned in words. It's as if this reward is so great that it's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can present this. He is the only one who can present this reward to you and I. Allah has chosen the greatest of months, the month of Ramadan. He has chosen within the greatest of months, the greatest night, the Laylatul Qadr. Within the greatest night, He chose the greatest of prophets, Muhammad, peace be upon him. For Muhammad, He chose the greatest of books, the Quran. And He chose to reveal it to the greatest place within the body of the Holy Prophet, as is mentioned in the Quran, عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنْدِرِينَ that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed this Quran onto the heart of the Prophet so that he can warn us. On the day of judgment, the Quran will come to our shafa'ah, will intercede for us the more we acquaint ourselves with it. It's interesting to note that in a hadith, we're told that recitation of the Quran, recitation of the Quran is one thing. That yes, we are to recite the Holy Quran. However, a step further than the recitation of the Quran is that you and I should study this holy book, that we should become familiar with it, friends with the Holy Quran. The Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, mentions in a tradition that the superiority of the Quran over any other speech is like the superiority of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over his creation. That shows you and I that there's something great in this book. Other ahadith from the Imma tell us that it never becomes old, even though it falls on the same ears continuously. This Quran never becomes old. You and I are witness to this. We hear the same verse continuously, or the verses continuously. It's a book that has no more than some 6,500 verses within it. But the more you read it, every time you come towards this book, you realize that there's something new you and I can extrapolate from it. There's a new lesson that we can learn from it. And it's a book that is applicable in every era and every time. It has principles within it, principles of universal principles of morality that continue throughout time. If it talks about justice, it's that justice that must be implemented throughout all periods of time. If it talks about the rights of one's spouse, these are rights that should be upheld throughout time. If it talks about how one should communicate with their children, if it talks about charity, these are not actions that are to be implemented at one time and not another. These are actions which will continue, principles of morality, which will make an individual a true human being. These are actions that will continue for the rest of time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within this Holy Quran has given you and I stories. Why? Because when we listen to stories, when we listen to anecdotes, they stick in our minds. Compared to listening to theoretical concepts, when we hear an anecdote or a story, especially if it's a true life story, when you watch a documentary, for example, it sticks in your mind more than somebody simply speaking about theoretical concepts that are taught in this documentary. If someone teaches you science, it's different to you watching a documentary and seeing this science unfold in front of your eyes. In the same way, Allah presents many a story within the Holy Quran and many an example. For example, there are times in the Quran where Allah says, "Have you not seen how the camel has been created? Or has the incident of Musa not come to you?" However, in all of these incidents, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses a third party narrator. He says, "Have you not seen how the incident of Musa came to you? Have you not heard about it?" He never makes himself the narrator of a story, except for this one particular story that we wish to discuss in this holy month of Ramadan. That is the most blessed story of the most handsome prophet after Muhammad, none other than Prophet Yusuf, peace be upon him. It is the 12th chapter in this most glorious book, the Quran. It comprises of 111 verses, but it's an extremely unique story. Why? It is the only lengthy chapter in the Quran which is a story from the first sentence to the last. There are smaller chapters which are stories, but in terms of the most lengthy surahs, in the most lengthy surah, it's this surah of Yusuf which is a story in chronological fashion from the first verse to the final verse, where Allah tells us about the story of Yusuf, not simply so that we can become acquainted with history, but so that you and I can understand the lessons that this prophet went through, learn from his life. Whenever Allah tells us about a story of a prophet, it's not simply so we can become acquainted with the prophet, it's so that you and I can understand what trials and difficulties this prophet went through. It's so that you and I can understand the ma'rifah and understanding this prophet had of Allah. How he looked at Allah, how he spoke to Allah, how he understood Allah. When Allah talks about Maryam in the Quran, when he talks about the wife of the Pharaoh in the Quran, it's not so that you and I should become ecstatic that these are individuals who believed in God. It's so that you and I can learn from them and then implement and act upon their actions too. The beginning of this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts with what are known as the disjointed letters, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alif Lam Ra, Tilka Ayatul Kitab al-Mubin. These are the verses of the clear book. Now this clear book, it is said that it's a book which is not with us, not this physical Quran, but a clear book which is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When this book is revealed to the heart of the Prophet, it comes in the form and the fashion that we have today. It comes in an Arabic form. It is very clear that Allah has chosen the language of Arabic above all other languages. If there is any gift we can give to the next generation, it's that you and I can teach them this beautiful language of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How beautiful it would be that we open the Quran and we're able to understand it as we're reading it. How beautiful it would be that we would be able to read the ahadith of the Holy Prophet and his family and understand it directly from their mouths, understand the wording that they're saying, the nuances within the Arabic language. It's a difficult language to understand, but it's a gift we can pass to the next generation. For many of us who may be first generation Muslims born here in the West, our parents did a great sacrifice for us by migrating from one part of the world to another. They did something great for us. It's now time that we do something great for our next generation as well. And there's nothing better than to be able to give them this language, which will open up an ocean to them, not only of the Quran, but also of ahadith of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Here is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we have revealed this Quran in an Arabic form so that you may understand it. And then he says a sentence which he doesn't say about any other surah in the Quran. He says, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ بِمَا أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. O Prophet of God, we are going to narrate to you the best of stories. Do you see how beautiful this is? That Allah says, the best of stories requires the best of narrators. I'm not going to simply make it come to you, O Prophet, from another narrator, from a third party narrator. The best of stories in the Quran requires the best of narrators. And the best of narrator is none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. So he tells the Prophet, we shall reveal this to you directly, not from a third party, not from a third narrator. And then he tells the Prophet, before this revelation, prior to this revelation, you were unaware of this story. It's possible the Prophet knew generally about this story, about the Prophet named Yusuf and Ya'qub. But he didn't know the intricacies that are going to be mentioned. The Jews came to the Holy Prophet, it is said, and they tried to corner him. They questioned him about Ya'qub's family. They asked the Holy Prophet, tell us, how is it that they moved from Palestine to Egypt? Thinking that the Prophet would not know about it because it was mentioned in their books, but not in the Quran thus far. However, the Holy Prophet, when this revelation comes to him, he doesn't simply give a straightforward answer and say that the Al of Ya'qub migrated from Palestine to Egypt because Yusuf became a king. Rather, it says everything else apart from a straightforward answer. It tells them about the intricacies of a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who relied on Allah and trusted on Allah through every difficulty that he fell into, such that Allah took so great care of him that he started off at the bottom of a pit in a well and he ended up as one of the greatest kings and advisors to the greatest king in Egypt. It shows how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he wants to debase someone, when he wants to annihilate somebody, he can take them from the tops and bring them to the bottom. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves a servant, he will take them from the pits of a well and make them the greatest of kings. Inshallah, in the coming episodes, we hope to discuss this most beautiful chapter of the Quran, this most beautiful story, particularly taking and extrapolating ethical principles that we can look at. We shall look at how Ya'qub speaks and communicates with Yusuf and the brothers. We will look at what happened between the brothers. We will look at what happened to Yusuf and how he relied on God and how God took great care of him. We'll look at how he went into the prison and what happened in the prison and what we can learn from this great prophet, not so that we can become ecstatic that this is one of our prophets, no. So that we can understand how we can implement the advice and the actions of this holy prophet so that we can walk on his path and become like him and gain closer proximity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ala ahli baytihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin.